Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition. Yes, I'm making my way through the WrestleZone roster one interview at a time. And on this edition, I've got Mauler Murphy. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
I'm very excited for this one. I'm liking speaking to these younger guys that are coming through that, because I've been watching WrestleZone since 2013. So that's.
Yeah, I don't feel so much like one of the younger guys anymore. With Evan and Rowan coming up.
I was going to say, I've had Evan on the show, and I'm hoping, touch wood, I'll have Rowan on, and Ronan on in the next couple of weeks as well on the show. So I'm making my way through you guys. I've still got some of the old guard to catch, but eventually we'll get everyone on WrestleZone, and then officially I can probably call this the WrestleZone podcast if you've listened to any past episodes. I'm a little bit obsessed with the company. First question,
no,
just a little bit, you know. I mean, I've got a little like Cassie here, not a little Scotty Swift. that my wife got me for Christmas. She got me a little Mr. P as well from the merch stand. So
you've just got minis of all the guys that have beaten me.
so I do. What a beautiful coincidence that is. Anyway, right, first question is always the same on this podcast when I get a brand new guest on. It's this bog standard wrestler question you get asked. What got you to pro wrestling? So what was the moment that got you hooked into this weird world?
I was kind of always somewhat into it. It wasn't something I focused too much on, but I got introduced to it by my cousins, and we used to always play the video games. So that's what kind of got me started into it. And then, of course, kind of grew out of it as I got older, because we weren't actually allowed to watch it in my house. It was a case of if my dad was the only one up, he would sometimes flick to Afterburn on a Sunday morning. And the thing about my dad, worst person to watch TV with if you're not specifically watching a show, because if he gets to an ad break, he'll just be like, all right, we're swapping to something that doesn't have ads. I'm like, no, I'm watching the Rey Mysterio match.
Oh, I remember that. I had that same rule. It was, yeah, I could play WWF. Attitude. I didn't have Warzone. I had Attitude, and I could play it. And if I was like, I shouldn't watch it, I was told. But I was allowed to go up and watch Heat on Channel 4. I was allowed to do that. Watch WWF Heat on Sundays. Then folks, if I had a good week, I could watch it in the living room. I could watch SmackDown on Sky One. It'd be a big day if I get to do that. And then if I'd be a particular dick that week, that was it. No wrestling. Yeah. The child tribulations of being young and trying to get into this weird wrestling stuff. So Rey Mysterio, is he one of your first favorites then?
Him and The Undertaker, those were my guys growing up. And then when I eventually got a bit older, Triple H was actually my guy.
All right, so
that was when he was doing his face run, kind of at the time. And like he was restarting DX 2006 roughly.
Right, I'm with you now. Yeah. That's fine. I was thinking 08 was my, kind of my brain timeline going for it. But yeah, it was 06. I loved that run. It was the first time I got to see WWE live really as good. Well. Oh. 2006 AECC. I don't know if you were possibly there that night as well.
No, I was still down in Fife at that point.
All right. Okay. So you're not a Aberdeen person.
I know my voice is, my accent is very difficult to place, but yeah, I'm not an Aberdeen born and bred.
Sorry, I get that. I mean, mine's the same. I don't know where my accent is. But I live in the Northeast, and Elgin. I've lived round about there the whole time of my life, but
if I had to pinpoint somewhere, probably the moon might be where my accent is. I don't know.
No, it seems so you've picked up little inflections, because my mom's got, she'll hate me saying this, but she's got a little bit of an English twang to her accent. But my dad's like Broad, Styx, Chichester, Glenlivet, you know, that kind of Speyside area. So I've kind of got this mix of that and a little bit of an English twang, which, you know, it's my posh phone voice. That's how it comes out. But my podcasting voice is just this monstrosity.
So this is just my calm voice. I have a very different voice when I'm angry, as anyone who see me wrestle will know.
Yes, we have heard the Mauler voice, and of course I got to hear it in on my birthday as well, when you did the birthday video message for me.
Yeah, that was a very confusing request. Just management, hey, Billy's got a birthday, we're just wondering if people can send this off. Like, you are aware you're asking me to do this, right? the new guy, the one no one likes.
Think okay, at that point,
I'll take it.
I don't think I'd seen you wrestle at that point, because the first time I saw you was Battle of the Nations, which was August.
With Bingo.
Oh, I did. I would have. No, hang on. I forgot my own age because I turned 30 in 2020. So I would have seen you wrestle because I saw you wrestle Caden Garrick at Battle of the Nations, the pre-show.
Right, okay, yeah.
So I had seen you at that point. I just looked at 2019 and thought, I was 30 then. No, I was 29. That's not that old. Not as old as I thought. Yeah, so watching it then, Undertaker, Triple H, Rey Mysterio, your classics. Was there any kind of off-brand favorites? So 2006, I'm thinking there's some random ones like your Highlanders, your Spirit Squad, you know, those classics.
I think I really liked MVP at the time, just because I saw him having the multicolored gear. It was very different for anything else. I was like, okay, he's interesting.
Yeah, definitely avoided the old black pants and kick pads look.
Yeah, it was a case of it would always be like a year or so between when I was like able to watch it, and it'd be like 3 weeks I'd get, and then it'd be another year. So right. I very rarely got to actually watch any of it properly until I actually moved up here. I moved up here for university, and then that's when What Culture and everything was like getting quite big with the behind the scenes stuff, like doing their videos and whatnot. So that, I don't know what happened. I think I was just drinking one night and I just saw it on YouTube and just piqued my curiosity. And then just kept watching, eventually got onto the actual product, found out there was a training school up here, figured I'd give it a go, and just never turned back.
That's usually my next question in this. So yeah, you're just drinking one night, saw there's a wrestling training academy in Aberdeen and thought, I'll give that a go.
I mean, I'm not sure if I was sober that night. This was my first year of university, so finding a sober night is very rare. But it was a case of, I wasn't super drunk where I woke up the next morning and saw I did this. I was like, what the hell? I just kind of saw it one time, and then I thought about it for a week or so, and then I was like, screw it. Like, worst that happens is I go to one session and then I don't like it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's probably good advice for anyone. It's like, at least try it once. I'm saying that who's never tried it. but yeah, if you've got a fleeting interest in doing it, you got to at least do it once to peak that interest. Done. Were you aware of WrestleZone beforehand, or was this just your first?
I had definitely seen their posters around. I remember the first one I saw was Christmas Chaos Comes Early with Mick Foley.
All right, okay. Remember
seeing that and go, oh yeah, I know him. Didn't realize he'd come to Aberdeen. That seems like a bit of an odd thing for him to do, but never ended up going to the show, unfortunately.
Felt odd at the time. 2015 then, that would have been, because, yeah. You know, a terrible knowledge for WrestleZone, surprisingly. But yeah, so 2015, it was weird. I don't know if you ever, did you ever go to shows, like once you started training, is that when you're kind of first introduced to WrestleZone properly? You go to shows or?
Well, I think what happened was I did the train, I put my request in for the training, and back then, like they waited a long time until they actually had enough people for a class. They weren't promoting the training school that much, so it wasn't a case of you had to find it. And so did that, and I realized I didn't know much about the company. And I remember seeing stuff like, oh, you should research the company you're going to. I'm like, crap. So I ended up going to their Union Square show that year, just seeing everything, making sure, I'm having absolutely no clue what I'm looking for, but just kind of like, okay, this seems like it's a good place, like good guys. They know what they're doing. The ring looks solid, everything like that. And then I got tickets for Anarchy.
What year was that?
That was 2016. So that was the one with Tatanka, Carlito, Hurricane, James.
Right. So that's Hurricane as well, wasn't it? So
yeah.
So and some weird. I was at that show as well, the Union Square one. Only briefly. I think it was only the second half of the year, because by the time I actually went to that one, I had a girlfriend at the time, so I couldn't get away with just sitting there the whole day, which I had previous years. But yeah, so weird that our paths may have unwittingly crossed at some point during that period of the day.
No doubt they would have.
More than likely. So yeah, so wrestle, that was your first experience, your first taste of it. So Union Square shows, really, for anyone that's not aware, they put a ring outside Union Square in Aberdeen. So you come off the train or come off the bus and it's there, pretty much.
Essentially.
And you get maybe there's like 10, 12 matches throughout the day, usually the same five guys. Ish, maybe some years.
Usually,
yeah, some years had Sammy and Debbie up, and they would have Emerson Jane and Debbie Dahmer. They're known as now. They would have them up, and they've got a couple of matches with them throughout the day. And yeah, like you're saying, you're getting a good taste of the core roster. You get to see the ring. You get to meet, maybe say hello to some people. And you're right with the training academy. I didn't even, like, I knew there was always this mysterious place where they were training these people. And then I think maybe only 3-4 years ago, they actually put out the address and where this is happening. And it was like,
well, when I was, when I started training, we didn't actually have the academy proper at the time. We were training in some scout hut with just some mats. The ring wasn't even put up. You had to go for special days where they would book somewhere else and they'd get the ring up for that and you'd just work the full day. Or if you went before a show and there was just enough time. But I didn't get into a ring until the actual training academy was bought, renovated. We actually had the full training academy at that point. That's when they started like pushing it.
Right. So before then, I can guess you would you've been tasked with helping build the ring, so you'd get a little bit of a feel of how it was put together.
Yeah, you kind of, you kind of wait a few months into your training before you do that. Just because if you invite everyone when they first start, most people don't come back after the first session.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's a case of you wait until you see who's sticking around, and once you figure that out, you get invited to help out with shows. And yeah, I think I was able to, I got that option. I think a couple months before the academy opened up.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose at the end, when I was putting like that, you do that when you started, you don't want a bunch of people in the crowd going, well, I know how this ring's built because I did one training session one day. Yeah. So yeah, it's letting, there's very much an initiation process I find with any, or induction process, I suppose, for any wrestling school, and that would be yours then. You'd have to work before getting to the ring. So what was that first couple of weeks like then? Of course, you're still doing it, so I'm assuming you liked it. But what was it like for the
pain? It was very sore, so it's very different from now. You do kind of the same things for your first couple sessions, but it's just kind of rolling on mats. I learned how to lock up, like real basic stuff, just like some cardio and whatnot. And I wasn't really used to working out at that point. And it was over the summer, so I was back and forth from my parents just over the holidays, and got the train up on the Sunday because they only did one training session a week at that point. And then I came back down the same night, woke up the next morning, and I had to basically crawl down the stairs because I was that stiff. So it hurt like hell, but I couldn't wait to go back.
Well, yeah, so clearly something obviously peaked it then, because you're coming back. I mean, if I do anything and it hurts me, I'm very much second guessing whether I'm going to come back and do it. So it is one of those where, I don't know, when you watch it on the TV, you thought, oh, first day I'll do all these sort of things. And then after that first session, you're like, right, that hurt, but if I keep doing this, I'll get to do the fun stuff. like your big boots and
whatever. But the fact that it was just one training session a week, we only just trained on Sundays, and the in-ring guys were able to train another day a week when it was just going to be them, like new inductions were just one day a week. So I had the full week to recover.
Mm.
So the Monday I was dead. The Tuesday I was still had trouble moving around. Wednesday I was fine. It's like, okay, can I go back now?
Like, please. It's like getting tattoos, isn't it? It's like you get a tattoo, it hurts like hell at the time. You take a couple of days going, oh, this is a bit tender. And then eventually, a week after, you're going, you know what I could need? I need another tattoo. That's what I need to do. That's totally forgot about the pain.
You catch the fever for it.
Absolutely. Was there anyone that it was in your class still about or made it to show?
No, it's actually something that I kind of joke about with some of the boys. That if you look at any new inductees, there'll be about 8 of them. And you kind of just look around and go, okay, who's the one that's going to stay? Because that's essentially the way of it. I had a very small group when I first started. It was me, Nova, and just some other guy. And 3 of us all stayed around a lot longer than I thought we would. The other guy kind of left after a year. Nova, of course, had the one match of Alienations. And then I'm still around. The next group was 2 people, Ted O'Keefe and someone else. So they stayed. I think the group that had the most success was Caleb Valhalla and Connor Molloy.
That's why I'm seeming to find him with this track. Between doing the interviews that I'm doing and the ones that obviously Mickey Vago's doing for his obligatory plug in a WrestleZone podcast for his mosh pit, it seems to be that you're right. It is either one or two make it through the whole thing. Doesn't matter how many start with. I don't know if it's a case of WrestleZone or I don't know if they're particularly hard, or maybe because at the point it was once a week, so they're like, it's not worth the bother. Maybe they're not really willing to do it.
There was only, I don't know before I started, but when I started, there was my group, there was Ted's group, then the Academy opened, and that's when Riley joined. And after that, we were open 5 days a week, I think. Mm-hmm. So by that point, it was just, you could go, just let us know when you're going to be in, but you can go as many times as you want. So after that point, it was, you could do that, but
yeah.
So there's a lot of factors as why people stop doing it.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, no doubt. There's obviously financial and physical being two prime ones. But yeah, as I said, I don't know if their reason is WrestleZone seem to kind of vet their roster really. They give you plenty of time to make sure you're ready to be in the ring for that first match. And sometimes you get that first match and it's not great. And you have to maybe take a couple shows off for you just to get those tweaks bits right. And then you'll come back and you'll be absolutely fine. I've seen it with other guys. I've seen people make debuts and then they're not great from my eyes. And then I'll see them at the next big show and they're just far and away so much better because they've had that little bit of experience. So as far as making your debut then, so I've got July 2019 at Proving Grounds. So this was kind of a little bit of a, not like an Academy show, but it had a little bit more newer faces on it, including yourself. Yep. And I think Caleb was possibly making one of his first matches.
I think he had definitely, it was one of his early matches, but he definitely had done a few before that.
Mm-hmm. So what was it like getting told that you were getting your actual in-ring debut?
It was really good because I'd had issues before that, but people always say, when did you start training? I can go, I've been started training about 6-7 years now, but I've only been training for about 3-4. Just had a lot of times where I've needed to stop. And then of course lockdown happened.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the thing. Yeah.
So it definitely was like, okay, this is a long time coming, but I know why it's been a long time coming. So I'm just looking forward to getting the opportunity and just seeing what it's going to be like.
So of course you made a debut against Assisto, which, you know, is always an interesting experience. What was your kind of inspiration? I don't know if you had the because I haven't seen the match because I didn't go to the show, what was the inspiration behind your gear, behind the character? What was your kind of thought process for Mauler Murphy?
Well, inspiration behind gear was Kevin Nash, really. I like the idea of the singlet and then the pleather trousers. I've just always kind of liked that look. Some people seem to not be very interested in it, as I have noticed, but it was kind of why I wanted to do it. So I wasn't able to really get much beforehand. I borrowed some really crappy pleather trousers, which I might as well just put bin bags on my legs instead. And I just wore a Training Academy top because it was just the closest thing I could get.
Yeah. I don't remember being very complimentary about the pleather. I don't like pleather trousers. That's it. Full stop. Crusher had them for a bit when he came back, and I hated them then. Right. It's very difficult to pull off. I don't even think Kevin Nash pulls them off particularly well. But it's something about them I don't like. But it's a look. It's certainly a striking look. People will remember them, good or bad. They'll remember Mauler Murphy. But how do you feel about that? It's a Assisto match, so it's not going to be a particularly technical affair. So
I'm not a particularly technical person.
So is it just a case of,
like, my matches are pick person up, put them down as hard as I can. That's kind of how my thought process for matches tend to go.
I mean, if it works, it works. So what was it like getting in front of a crowd then? Because WrestleZone, I'm a very passionate fan base. Some could be queued all day to see someone. So what was it like in front of them for the first time?
Well, I'm coming out. I'll get my game face on. No real idea how they're going to get me. I figured they're just going to look at a big guy and just like, no, we don't like you. And yeah, they definitely didn't like me that night. There was a kid in, I think, like the third row or something, just kept screaming throughout my match that I was a psychopath. And it's really difficult to stay like focused on your match and trying not to laugh at this kid. Just like, oh, this kid doesn't know what I can do yet. He's just calling me a psychopath straight away.
That's amazing. So he's got the character straight away. Great. Oh, he hasn't seen me actually wrestle yet. Ah, shit.
Yes, judge me on first impressions. Good way of doing it.
That's the weird thing about wrestling. You're supposed to, in real life, you're not supposed to judge someone straight away. Wrestling, first thing you do, as soon as you come out the curtain, you are judged straight away until you do something. You're like, right, I don't like look at you. Show me something. And then you just scowl and go,
I don't like you.
I was right not to like you. Boo. So your first match in, so July 2019, how did you feel afterwards? Do you feel like you're ready for that? Do you think, I'm going to guess you had a million things.
I definitely feel like it could have gone better. Like, I don't think anyone thinks back to their first match and think, yeah, perfect, wouldn't change a thing. But it was a case of I went back and I had a lot of things in my head, like, okay, could have done that, right? That would have been a bit better if I did that. And I just kept thinking about stuff that I could have done and should have done, because I'm very critical of everything I do. I don't think I've ever been happy with a match I've done yet.
I suppose it's one of those things where much like starting training, you're not going to know until you try. You're not going to know how that first match is going to be until you have that first match. And then you can take and go, right, I need to do this, I need to do that. A lot of things I find with again, seeing first few guys' matches is like, they don't know how to pull themselves up. It's a weird thing where I think people just kind of, I don't know if it's a confidence thing, whether you need to, where you want to focus so you can hunch over and then you're like concentrating on the match.
I don't think it's so much of a confidence thing. It's more of a generic thing. You go through your life, most people are hunched over just kind of the standard thing. So you just think, okay, at natural.
Yeah.
Essentially. So then having to think, no, I need to look big and project. So then like subconsciously do it. And then you get to 9 minutes into a match and you're just like, okay, focus on the breathing. And then everything goes away after that point.
I mean, we'll touch on all the matches that you've had, but the two I've seen anyway from you was, of course, August 2019, Battle of Nations pre-show, which I've already mentioned, against Caden Garrick. And this is the first time I'm seeing you. So I'm seeing a brand new person. I'm seeing the pleather trousers. I'll put them out of my mind for the minute and concentrate on the actual wrestling. And but the difference between that and then me seeing you at Halloween Hijinks, October 2021, it was that thing of you were like heavily concentrating in the first match I saw you in. And then when I saw you come out of Halloween Hijinks, I don't know whether it was the crowd, we'll get into it more later on, but you were just like, you were projecting instead of like hunched and concentrating. So I don't know, again, it could be subconscious. You might not even know you're doing it, but it was something I noticed anyway when I was watching back. There wasn't even a question there, so I'll move on. It was just a statement. That's often happens in these podcasts where I start a point and then realize that I've went 2 minutes, 3 minutes speaking and I haven't asked a question at all. I've just ranted for a little bit and
basically
and hope that people have been entertained.
It's nice to get the feedback.
Exactly. We do reviews for every wrestler on the show, whether it's myself or Adam now, so it's
yeah, almost, I remember the one for the last show I did.
We started doing fantasy booking advice. It's great. It's just what you need from wrestling fans. it's fantasy booking. Brilliant.
It was just funny. One of my mates got a message from someone just saying, oh God, someone check on Mauler.
I think by signs of it, you've taken it in the right way. We are not, certainly I am, and I'm sure Adam is. We don't go out to be mean for no reason, or at least we tried to be constructive.
I just laughed.
That's fine. That's absolutely fine.
I opened up my phone. I was reading through the rest of the matches. Then I got to my one with P, and it just first line, well, Mr. P, you tried. I just burst out laughing.
It's all right. You've taken it far better than like Jimbo Bannon did, who was furious after I did one of his matches. Because I saw him like months later in Keith, and he just hard stared me the whole time his match. And I really enjoyed this match afterwards, but
the way I look at it is the like essentially fan reviews, they're nice, fun reads, but if I'm looking for actual criticism, I know who to go to for those.
Yeah, exactly. You go to your trainers, you go to people that are actually doing. Like say, I do say that every time I give feedback, is I've never done it. I've just watched it. Right. So just you take it all with a grain of salt if I'm going, oh, you should do this. Because, you know, I'm nobody. Right. So Battle of the Nations comes around. You're in the pre-show against Caden Garrick. So this seems like a bit more of a match instead of you and Assisto. It's two big powerhouse guys that are going to just... It's the old cliche that somehow become vernacular of big men slapping meat. That's how it came to be. And this is the first match I saw of you. So it really was just two big dudes battering lumps at each other. Is that kind of something you like? Is it just... Do you like that kind of hard hitting style?
Yeah, I do like the kind of hard hitting style because it's something I don't get to do a lot of. Like, a lot of the guys are quite smaller than me, so it's just a case of when I get a chance of, I mean, a guy who can match me with strength and size, and Caden's strength, more strength than size. But it was a case of, yeah, I was liking the opportunity to just kind of bash horns with someone and just see who breaks first, which turns out was him.
So it's just a good old-fashioned brawl, which is sometimes that's what you need, yeah, in a show. You need variety is the spice of life. Sometimes you just need a good brawl.
Yeah, we liked it so much, we did it twice.
Exactly, I was about to say. Then moved on to Tara, Tara, or wherever you are from, however it's pronounced, but it's Tara for us Chukters. You defeated Caden Garrick again. So this is kind of your first mini feud on the pre-shows. So you got to do a little bit of back and forth. Were you able to put a little bit of story into these two matches? These are coming back. Were you conscious of that? Or again, was it just you trying to just to focus on getting the matches done, getting the moves down, and then being able just to batter lumps at each other?
Well, I'm generally quite good at remembering stuff. So I kind of knew what I was needing to do during the match. So I was kind of focusing more on everything else I needed to do. But it was a case of we did think a wee bit of trying to get actual story in it. We didn't have a lot of time to plan. So I can't remember what the reason was, but I was needing to get a later car in. So I was put with Damien, Alan Sterling, and I think another staff member. I can't remember who it was. But of course, they're in the main event, so they're taking their time. Like, they're stopping off at places to grab food because they weren't able to get stuff. And I'm just the nervous rookie in the back going, I might miss my match.
Hey guys. Yeah. Hey guys, I need to be here.
Alan Sterling kind of picked up on my nerves a wee bit, and he gave me a bit for it, but it was, he's a funny guy, so I can't blame him.
Oh, everything I've seen, I'm hoping to get him on the show. We were supposed to have him on last year, but of course stuff meant that couldn't. But hopefully we'll get him on in the future, because that's all I hear about. Everyone that's ever spoke about Alan Sterling is just has so much
that
joy.
Would probably be, like, not to downplay my own episode, but that would probably be the best episode you'll ever have.
Well, I'm going to have to top it for the mosh pit where he went for a piss during the show, and it was recorded. So, you know, there's a lot to top. Had this back and forth with Caden Garrick, and then Inverurie rolled round, and this is your first, like, I'm not saying your first proper match, but you're against Scotty Swift. So this is your one of your trainers, obviously a huge name in WrestleZone, a big fan favorite. So obviously it's going to be very easy for the crowd to hate Mauler Murphy, but
it was very easy for the crowd to hate me that night.
So what was it like going in with Scotty? So of course, the guy that did kind of taught at least a good portion of what you knew at that point, was like finally getting into the ring in front of a crowd with him.
I was really looking forward to it, because not only was it a case of I was getting in with Scotty, it was also my first match where there was a pre-show and I wasn't on it. So it definitely seemed more like more of an elevation. So I was like, okay, this is definitely more interesting. So we started talking about the match, and this was also another one where it was a guy more my size, more my strength. So we were able to do a bit more of the actual, like, proper brawling stuff. And, like, during the match, I was just fully into the whole thing, just really going, Then I got back and rewatched the match. I was like, oh God, what was I doing at the time? But I liked it because we were able to add a wee bit more story stuff into it.
Oh yeah, Scotty's definitely a master at doing that. He knows that crowd like the back of his hand. He'll know how to push their buttons. So you're able to. Was that one of the matches where you came out, like you said, you watched it back and thought, oh, I don't know what I'm doing, but was that something you were able to go, I've saw what Scotty's done here. I can see how he's looked at the crowd for this moment, and you're able to kind of pick pieces for your own kind of work.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those ones when you watch back your own matches, you know in your head what you were thinking at the time. You were thinking how you looked, and then you watch it back and you realize how you actually looked. Like, you think you're like going, and you're actually just,
Right.
Like, okay. Realizing how bigger you need to actually be.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I understand that. Was there any wrestlers you watched to try and get that? Kind of, you said you're inspired by Kevin Nash by your gear. Was he a guy that you'd watched to see how he did things because of his size? Was there anyone in particular? Undertaker, I'm guessing, was one as well.
Early Undertaker specifically, back when he was doing the original Dead Man. That's kind of where I went back to. I did watch a couple of Kevin Nash's. Vader was one as well. Kind of had to learn very quickly. Just see what he's doing posture wise. Don't take his moves into account. Because otherwise, the boys are not going to like you if you do those.
And we're not going to see a Mauler moonsault anytime, no?
I mean, I can try. It will be the last ever Mauler Murphy match you see, but I could definitely give it a go at some point.
You never know. Bust out like in a Brock, well, say Brock Lesnar did a shooting star press, but that didn't really.
I definitely go well. probably shouldn't do that one.
So I'm liking that you're checking out these big guys because of your height, especially that because there's not that many guys your size in WrestleZone. Crusher maybe. Crusher. I mean, as you say, Scotty, he's kind of you don't realize how tall Scotty is really until he's with the smaller guys. You go, Jesus, he's actually a fair height. Maybe it's the spikes.
There's a decent number of guys there that are still really tall, like Riley, Bradley, Scotty. They're all 6'1". Me and Crusher are further up in the 6 foot range, but we're only a few inches really taller than them.
Has Crusher been a guy you've been able to, because he's done it for years now, and he's a big guy. Is he a guy that you're able to...
He's someone whose brain I try and pick as much as I can whenever I can. Mm-hmm. A real issue is I was like, tried to like do all that, but then when you get to a certain level, I always find in whatever you do, where you know you don't know a lot, but you don't know what you don't know. So it's a case of like, I know I need to ask him something. I don't know what I need to ask, but I know I need to ask him something.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So you know there's a bit missing. You just don't know what the bit is to actually ask to find the bit. Okay. Yeah. That's. That makes sense, absolutely. And then, of course, that was all your matches. And then, well, at that point, then you were supposed to make your Regal Rumble debut in 2020. Of course, we were all excited for the Regal Rumble. We were all buzzing because, you know, all these names coming back, all these new faces. Then COVID. So,
yep.
I think it was cancelled just like, the week of, I think, the Regal Rumble. Because
week before, it was very close to it.
Yeah, because I think I bought tickets to go to Inverness SWA that day for the Regal, because I gave my wife the choice, Inverness or Aberdeen. She chose Inverness, wrongly. I know. And then when that got cancelled, I was like, right, first thing, buying tickets to WrestleZone, sorted. And then day later, cancelled. So when you find out shows are cancelled, this COVID thing's a little bit scarier than you think. How did you kind of, I do have a note how you kept some of your time occupied, but what was your first initial thoughts? Was it just keep your cardio up? What was your kind of reaction?
When it got cancelled, like, we didn't know if there was going to be a lockdown yet. Like, there were rumors of it. There was people talking about it. People were going, I don't think they will. Don't think they can't. So it's like, I don't know. So I was kind of just, I was just disappointed that the show got cancelled. Like, it was my kind of meant to be a big return. And then it just got swept under the rugs. I'm like, okay, well, we can still train. So I'll just keep at it, get better, and that'll be even better than it would have been originally. It was kind of my thought process. Then lockdown happened. I was like, okay, now I can't do anything. But I kind of looked at it as to, well, if I'm, people are going to go crazy during this thing. So I'm going to just try and find something to focus on. So I focused on my health, just getting my diet sorted, doing whatever home workouts I could. I just kind of keep myself busy as much as I can. Don't think about how the world's burning. Just think about this instead.
Yeah, because I was noticing when I was doing my research, most of my research usually consists of going to cage match and then scrolling through the person's Twitter feed. And, you know, it works. So I was noticing that, yeah, you were going through this weight loss journey. Yeah, at one point, I think you lost a stone. You were kind of on it. It's just a case of just trying to think, because you had all that time not to go outside. You're able to kind of tweak and find things and find alternatives, because just to maybe not think you're dieting. I think that seems to be the key, apparently.
It was a case of, I looked at alternatives. I went back to stay with my parents during lockdown because they wouldn't accept me staying by myself. They were like, no, we won't feel okay if you're by yourself. So, okay, well, I'll come home. So yeah, we did that. And so I was able to kind of focus on healthier meals without having to realize, okay, I need to focus on knowing I need to buy this, this, this. Basically, my bills were paid for, and then otherwise I could just focus on what I needed to. So yeah, focus on that. And then just a bunch of home workouts, a lot of high intensity interval stuff. Just trying to simulate matches as much as I could with what little I had. That's kind of how I did it. I didn't have an end goal in mind. It was just get as good as I can get.
I mean, because I suppose at that point, start of lockdown, you didn't know if it was going to be 4 weeks or 4 months, or as it turned out.
Well, when it first started, everyone's like, well, I'll be done in 3 weeks. It'll be a nice little holiday. And then it was 2 months.
I know. And now it's, well, it's been, March 2019, when people started getting sent home, like myself, and I'm still at home. I'm still working from home, and it's just, it's crazy. I'm enjoying it, but that's it. You've got to find a glimmer of hope in some form. One is, I could take my time to do a podcast now instead of traveling to work to and from. But you know, some people aren't so lucky. So yeah, there you go, Rumble. Are you back in the office or everything?
I'm a salesman, so shops have opened again. So
right, okay, yeah. So you get to deal with the idiots in public then. I'm sorry, not idiots, the public. You get to deal.
Yes, I get to deal with the public.
Law, I do not envy you at all. So during that time, of course.
Why do you think I'm so angry in my matches?
I can see you must be channeling through that.
I can't scream at the customers. So, Sisto, you're getting screamed at.
You're just looking at Sisto and just imagining a wee old wifey who's got a receipt that's out of date, and they can't return this item. I'm going to punch you in the face. figuratively.
Figuratively. We'd never do that.
No, absolutely. We only punch sisters. So I was looking through like things you got to during that time then, and a lot of it was, of course, was training seminars as well. You did a lot of the FPWA stuff, which is strange now because, of course, you started training in Aberdeen and you're moved back to Fife during this lockdown, and then you end up doing FPWA training. So you're actually doing training in Fife, like in Fife.
it
works out.
Well, that's what happened with that was, so I was up here for university to begin with, why I moved to Aberdeen, started my training when I was at uni, unfortunately failed uni. Turns out you have to pass every class. Didn't tell me at the time. So moved back down south, got a job, and I was coming up here on the train every couple days a week. And I was thinking, okay, no, I need to get back up here to actually properly train. Like this, it's not going to work long term. So eventually found a job up here, got a flat, was able to move up. And literally the next week, the FPWA was announced. So I was like, oh, come on.
It's like they waited for you. It's like, well, I'm going to get Mauler out of Fife and then we'll open up.
Like, if he comes, we'll scare away everyone else.
So you end up doing things like Matt Cross, I noticed. Of course, Andy Wild, obviously, because FPWA.
There was a lot of guest seminars on that one.
I know. Another one I noticed, of course, was Viper as well, or Dewdrop, or Piper Niven. As always, you've got to say all three names when you speak about her, because nobody's 100% sure what to go with.
This was pre-Dewdrop.
It, it, So yeah, we'll go Piper. Shrewd and Piper Niven at that point.
We'll go Piper Niven.
So especially ones like Piper and that is probably ones that you were, and Andy Wilde, of course, two very ones be heavily interested in you because they're, again, they're working a bigger size, bigger style. Is there anyone else that particular that came on you were like, maybe you didn't think you'd take as much as away as you thought you would? Anyone in particular?
Wish I could remember his name. He's a photographer. I was one of the guys from down south. I can't remember what his name was. It was the one name on the thing. I was like, I don't know who this is. And I tried to find like matches online thinking it was just a wrestler. I didn't know. It's like, okay, I can't seem to, we'll see who this is. And it was just one of the photographers that's down south, takes photos of guys during the matches and whatnot. Not one of, not our guys, but it was a case of, because he watches that much and he's been around that long, he had that much knowledge and was just able to, basically was able to work as much as any veteran and give us advice. So I learned quite a bit from that one. But I was taking something away from every sort of seminar.
I suppose for a photographer, he's seen enough of like in-ring positioning to at least have an idea of what's right and what's wrong, or at least has a good feeling of what's right and what's wrong, and that can easily help. Especially if you want to get your photos out there, you're gonna need to have a little bit of back and forth with the photographer to know where to be and get these cool shots. And the one we've used for your match graphic is one from Brian Battensby that we've used as well. So
yeah, I noticed that one.
You're particularly happy in that one.
Yeah, well, I was thinking when I saw that, I was like, before you actually posted it, I was thinking, okay, they seem to use match graphic ones for everyone else, so they'll probably use the one for Christmas. And you used a photo from Christmas anyway. Instead of my match graphic where I'm looking angry and everything, it's just me looking bloated from the side going,
I can change it if you want.
That's all right. Don't worry.
To be honest, it's because everything this podcast is, everything I've done is working with very little knowledge and anything. So I just picked a one that I could see both your arms in, because I found graphics where it's like it looks great, but then like half their arms cut off. I thought, well, I can't put that on because this is how I need the position to be. I need like the top half of your body.
No, so, that's fair enough.
So I found that one. I thought, oh, it looks all right. It looks scary. Good. That's the one. Cut out. And it goes. I wouldn't even say you look bloated. You look lovely. So don't worry about it.
You old charmer.
I'm buttering you up just before I end up coming through for Regal Rumble. And
I won't kill you during the Rumble then.
Yet. Depends what we shout at the show, I suppose.
We'll see.
So you did a lot of that. And go back to training as well, because it's a note at the top of my page, which I've missed. You did things like train with Santino, of course, when up for Avenue Anarchy. So as far as like, as we're on a kind of subject of training, I was like, being in with these guys when Avenue Anarchy season rolls around, did you get in the ring with Santino? And I don't know if you're able to, if you got time with Chavo or Pac or any of those guys, but was it just, again, a wealth of knowledge?
Well, we do try and get seminars with as much of the people as we can. I think Santino was the only one from like former WWE guys we were able to get, at least since I've been here. But it was a very good session. And it was one of the funny things, all of us got put in our training gear and everything, and we were fully ready for a full physical session. And he's just sort of settled down, started talking. And then 2 hours had passed. And he was like, oh, sorry, guys, we're going to have to stop there. It's like, that's good then.
I'm here, nice and comfy in. I'm ready to go. You were saying?
Yeah, so like some seminars are better than others, but it's a case of I've learned something from everyone other than one. I would say there was one seminar that was particularly bad.
Are you willing to name them?
I'm not willing to name them.
Right. Okay.
I will let other people who have more heat with them do that. But
I think I may be able to guess, but we'll leave that name out if it's who I think it is. So that's fine. I'm sure.
But it was a case of there was like two seminars, some for the experienced guys, some for the newer guys. And he decided to, on the newer guys one, I don't know if he did it on the experienced guys one, just go, okay, so the way I like to do seminars is you tell me what you want to do. And we're all like, we learned hip tosses the other day. We don't know what the fuck to do. So yeah, that was a very awkward seminar.
I would like to do 6:30 splashes, please. Can you basically teach me how to do that?
It was a case of we just picked like specific, very basic move. Like I think I asked him like to look at my splashes in the corner because it was all we could think of. It was like tiny little things.
Anyway,
so that one wasn't a very good one, but it was a case of
you just take what you're given kind of thing.
He did a Q&A at the end, so we learned a bit then.
So of course all that time has passed. So October 2019 being your last match, and then of course 2 years later, I think you put 2 years and 4 days.
It was very close to the day.
Halloween hijinks returned. You weren't announced for the show because you accepted Lord Mr. Malice's open challenge.
Yep.
So the first face that everyone saw after 2 years of 18 months of no wrestling, no wrestle zone, is Mr. Malice. So you know,
setting it off on a good one.
That seems to be the best. That sets the tone quite nicely. And then of course the second face we see after Jeeves is you. So Mauler Murphy's accepted the open challenge here. Before we actually get into like happened to the match itself, what was it like? Did you think you'd miss the crowd as much as you thought you would have? Because I saw a lot of faces come out that night and their faces kind of like dropped when they saw like a crowd or noise or people. What were your kind of feelings going into that first show again?
For me, it was the exact same as it was for the other matches because I've not had that much experience in front of crowds. So that's still a very big novelty for me.
Mm.
And it felt a lot better because this was the biggest crowd I worked across. Like, I think almost everyone bought a ticket for the VIP match that was actually there that night. I think only like 10 other people went in for the main card. So it was a case of, I had basically a full Northern Hotel watching me do the entrance and thinking, why the hell did he come out? Who do I cheer in this situation?
Well, I will say though, I was just glad to see the bin bags were gone and you actually had gear.
that was something a lot nice. Of the boys backstage were saying when I've got us dressed and ready to go. They're like, okay, you look a lot better now that you actually have gear.
You know, that was like almost my first thought was like, oh my God, he's got rid of the pleather. This is ace. It's going to be great.
I mean, I had 2 years. If I hadn't got rid of the pleather in that amount of time, then something was very wrong.
I know. Anyway, but yeah, you said it looked better, looked a bit more fitting for you. It seemed to suit Mauler Murphy a bit better. Of course, you came out, everyone's excited for the first match back. You then accept to be a team with Mr. Malice. I don't know how we can call this alliance.
Allegiance. Well, he was offering to just like, we skip the match and then he'll pay for a buffet. So my thought process for that was just, okay, well, I was planning to come out and beat his ass, but I could get a bunch of food for free, and if he doesn't pay, I'll still beat his ass.
No brainer.
So yeah. Win-win for me.
Unfortunately, that was all interrupted by Bingo Balance for the first like proper roar of the night. We're getting to see this triple threat.
No one expected him to come out at that point.
Not at all. Not a single person.
Which I really think, though, fact that we did the order of who came out really helped with that, because you say like first face we saw was Mr. Malice, then we saw Jeeves, then I come out and everyone's just like, what the hell is this segment even about? And then, oh, we've got a countdown. Who is it? Oh, it's one of the biggest fan favorites we have at WrestleZone that we don't get to see very often.
Popping up on the pre-show, you know, just randomly. So that's again another.
Well, you know, anyone can turn up on the pre-show. You know, just thinking.
There we go. Of course, then the pre-show now known as the Vago in person section after his pre-show debut at Summer Hill Showdown, which apparently he's stealing now as part of his thing, which is fair. He can.
Everything's Vago's.
Everything's Vago. Vago owns all. So, that was the first match back. So again, another very experienced. So first match back, two very experienced opponents. Even though we do make jokes about Malice, he's been around long enough to know what he's about. And of course, Bingo Balance. Yeah.
He was smart enough to just get out of the ring and let us do our thing.
And they've got Bingo Barnes, of course. I don't know how it happened, but he ended up being the subject of, I don't know if you listen to Wrestling Daft at all, with Rav Florence and Grado. He ended up being one of their absolute favourites. I think they just picked his name out of a hat and just became Bingo Barnes is the best thing ever. And he ended up appearing on there. So he's he had a little bit of a social buzz about him as well coming into this match. Then you have, like I said, these experienced opponents. For your first match back as well, what was the match like? I mean, I watched it, you were in it.
I just absolutely loved it, like, because this was especially someone who could do a lot more than in the ring. Because say the previous ones I had was a Sisto and then two big strong boys. So this was someone who still big, like he was able to pick me up, but he does a lot more flippy. He does a lot more high flying. So that was a very different sort of opponent for me to be in the ring with. So I was looking forward to just that experience. And also just hoping Malice stayed out as much as possible.
Well, we say that, but Malice, of course, he landed on your face. So
Yeah. Well, he also cost me the match. Like, I had Bingo beat, and then he just lifts my hand up. I was like, wait, I'm still pinning him.
But I remember a lot of stuff coming out of it was Malice land. I think he was doing his senton. He missed Bingo and landed on you.
I can't remember if it was the first, like, top or second rope, but he did the senton, landed on me instead.
Which did not look pretty. Of course, I don't think it's ever meant
to be. Well, I kind of know it's not supposed to be a fun thing to take, but I didn't take it correctly, essentially. Because I was told if I'm ever taking a move like that, like, turn your head. Mm-hmm. And I thought, I kind of knew to do that anyway, but I was like, okay, so I had it turned to begin with. And then he lands on my chest, like, as we're going down. So I realized, oh, he's landing on my chest, that's fine. I can move my head back so I can, like, land in a more comfortable position. We land, he then bounces and then lands on my face. So now I'm rolling out, like, trying to catch my breath because I've just had a big man land on me, and then I'm just like, is my jaw dislocated? Thankfully, it wasn't.
So, welcome back to wrestling. Here's Malice's arse in your face to kick on with. And of course,
I earned my paycheck that night.
And of course, it wasn't a win to start off with, but it's still it was just, I suppose, like you're saying, you didn't have enough crowd experience to miss it, kind of thing.
Yeah. So,
but it was still nice. It was nice to see wrestling again. When I was watching it, I couldn't believe how much I missed it, and just as a fan. And I think my wife pointed out that I looked like I was in tears at some point, and I was just like, I just missed the wrestling. It's just, I've had to watch shows on the Thunderdome for the last 2 years. This is a thing I need to see now. I need to see wrestling live.
Yeah, I think that was my biggest kind of reaction was, oh yeah, wrestling is supposed to have crowds. That was kind of my biggest takeaway from it.
Oh yeah, some of those Thunderdome shows were a nightmare. So yeah, we had that, and then of course you're back for Christmas Chaos against Mr. P, as we pointed out. The two little dolls I've got. I mean, I need a Bingo Balance one now to collect the set. But so you got in.
Every time I lose a match, just get a list. Okay, I need to get that doll now. I need to get that doll.
I know, it's some sort of weird voodoo stuff that I'm going to have to start collecting them. I'll get Sisto, and then you go worry for your next match with them. So this is your first singles match, though, Christmas Chaos, and it's on the main show as well. It's not in the pre-show. So this is your first proper, full, I mean, even though, like you say, VIP at Halloween Hijinks was everyone bar 10 people. But Christmas Chaos, your first proper show, Dainston Community Centre, full crowd. Have heard the crowd was a bit that night, but
they weren't like the most enthusiastic, most energetic, but the kids were still loud enough. Like, they made noise in our match. That's all I cared about.
But, I mean, yeah, that is the most important thing a lot of the time. So I guess Mr. P, of course, another huge fan favorite. He's not.
Oh yeah.
He's not the biggest guy, as in broad, big guy, but he is quite tall, so he's a bit of a lanky fella, in the most complimentary way I could put it. So yeah, this match, again, another different kind of opponent. It was just another fun test for you to work a different style.
what we kind of knew what this match was. It was just a match for me to get experience, get him on the show, and just give the kids a bit of fun. So it was one of those things where there's a lot of things in that match that happened that I probably wouldn't have done in any other match, just because my character is supposed to be quite a serious one. And here I am getting kicked up the arse repeatedly, which he does not hold back. Like, it was great in the moment. And then I got backstage, I'm like, I might not sit down for a bit.
Ice bath, an ice pillow, just to kind of take away the pain.
I did have to think for a second, was that when he was doing the kicks or when I slipped? Because yeah, there was a bit in the match. Yeah, there's a bit in the match, I will say, for those who don't know, was planned. I did have the boys asking me afterwards, like, was that meant to happen? Yes, it was. We're doing the whole running around the ring spot, and then we're doing a bit where he goes in for a corner, we stare at each other, and we just keep switching in and out. And it ends when I go back out again, and I just slip and fall, which is just like, haha, look at the idiot. So, yeah, but of course, doing that, I land on my arse. On the wood. So yeah, that was not the funnest bump of the night.
Did you find that was, I don't know, like you say, Mauler Murphy is supposed to be a serious character, you know, he's supposed to be the big scary guy. Did you enjoy being the I don't want to say buffoon seems really harsh, but you know, just the big silly monster for the night with Mr. Pease?
Well, I enjoyed it for at least that opening bit, because that's kind of where the whole like silly bit started. It's kind of when I eventually took over, that was when we're just okay, no, we're back to serious now.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I did enjoy it. It was something different to do, and I'm like, outside the ring, I'm the guy that likes to make jokes and just make people laugh, so I was fully up for actually doing something like that for a change. But yeah, yeah. It was fun. It was something to do. Wouldn't recommend falling on the wood again. Probably change that next time. But yeah, it was fun.
Excellent. So that's kind of us covered your matches. So we'll kind of work, see what else we've got we can pick up. Well, I'll ask my stupid questions and we'll go to the fan questions, because we did get a couple. Even though Mark Leslie did ask, don't ask many stupid questions, I've got two that I ask anyway.
Well, so, what's the point? Like, you need to ask the stupid questions.
Exactly. And the two I've got are stupid. So the first one we ask everyone is, I'm going to leave the first one to second, because you say you've done some research. The other question we ask is, what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
Yeah, sorry, man, what's that? You're...
The stupid questions have arrived, and the technology's died.
Technical difficulties.
Back on a moment. All right. And then we can ask these silly questions. Go with the headphones. Sometimes you just need wires.
There we go.
Excellent. I thought we were going to ask our stupid questions and your technology.
These things died.
See, wireless technology useless. So wires are best. So yeah, I was just laughing saying you're obviously. I was going to ask my stupid questions. Your technology just went no. Let's not. But what would win the fight?
No, this is a very serious podcast. Yes, we take things very serious around here.
So yeah, two sheep or one cow, what would win?
Sorry, what was the two options?
Two sheep or one cow in a fight.
I'm going to go with the cow.
The cow's starting to run ahead in this particular season. The belief of two sheep.
Well, the big question is it like, because like, cows are the females and sheep are the females. Rams are the males. Bulls are the males. So it depends generally which way you're going, because two rams might beat one cow. But if we were just going by plain sheep and plain cows, then nah, cow's got it.
I like your thought.
I don't know what one sheep could do. Never mind two. Like to a cow.
I like your thought process. I like people question it, because I've had people just like. Like I said, that's just the question. So if you use your imagination, it could be two rams or against the bull. That's all on you. But yeah, I had Joe Henry give me a telling off, because the question was so vague. I was like, that's just the question. You just it's not a serious question. It's not something you have to hinge your life on. Other than that, of course, what's your favorite dinosaur?
So I wasn't actually able to ask Ryan Riley for his research. I was meaning to, but I've not run into him yet. So I've had to just go by my limited knowledge, aka I rewatched Jurassic Park.
Fine.
And I'm going to say Triceratops.
Oh, nice. That's a nice classic one. One of my favorite Power Rangers as well. You know.
Cause... Yeah, that was also one of the other reasons I was thinking. Hey, what were all them again? What was the blue one? Triceratops. Okay, yeah, that's what it was.
Of course, Billy. Cranston. Billy Cranston, the blue Power Ranger. So yeah, it's, like I said, these are the super serious questions we ask. But we've got more in the Twitter as well. Then I'll ask about your YouTube stuff, because I'm very intrigued by it as someone who does YouTube stuff, apparently. That I want to know what your thoughts are on it. So I've got questions here. We've got another nice serious one from Robbo from the We Talk podcast. He just asked, what's your favorite fish? I don't know why.
Considering it's that big, I'm going to say battered. My favorite fish is battered.
Beautiful answer. I will take it. As a chunky man, I can appreciate a nice battered fish. I've got Dan Murphy asking, if I join up, can I be Mini Murphy and we could be a tag team? A relation of some sort?
This is just one of my mates from school. We just had the same last name. That's all it was. You know what, Scout? If you want to be my tag team partner, FPWA's in Fife. Go train. Stop the American football, and we'll see how you do.
There you go. The Murphy brothers coming soon. And we've also got Spyro as well on Twitter asking, why have you never seen Lord of the Rings?
I'm going to answer this question with a question myself. Spyro, why have you not seen Die Hard?
Whoa, hang on, what? I mean, I get never seen Lord of the Rings. It's like a 3 days out of your life you can't dig it back, but the Die Hard.
See, this was the thing. We went to go see Spider-Man No Way Home, and then afterwards, we were just talking about like a bunch of films and saying, so have you seen something like, nah. So it's like Gremlins, Ghostbusters and whatnot. Like some of the things that if Scotty Swift knew about, I'd be dead. But it was just a case of, I've just never got around to seeing them. I know they're classics. I would definitely watch them if they get put on, but I've just never seen them. It's like, oh, that sucks. Eventually got on, talk about action films. I said, oh yeah, I've watched Die Hard over Christmas period. Yeah, never seen it. Okay, you can't get on at me now then.
I don't think I know anyone that's never seen Die Hard. It's just it's a staple of, the first three. The third you can waver on, but no, the first three, a perfect trilogy. Then they ruined it by adding more. But Lord of the Rings. I've said in other podcasts. I can't. I don't have time in my life to care enough about Lord of the Rings. It's too long. I find it boring.
I think I've watched like half of Fellowship because I like downloaded it off Netflix one time to watch when I was on the train. But it was only an hour and a half train journey, so I only got halfway through it.
Yeah.
Which kind of tells you how long these bloody movies are.
I know, it's like when they go on about, oh, it's a special edition, they've got another 6 hours of content and extras. I'm like, no, just no. I mean, saying that, I will watch, like, I would probably, if I was given the choice, watch all the Marvel films back to back to back to back, all 30 of them, no bother at all. But, you know, just, you like what you like.
This is what really worries me about them saying that there's an early director cut of the new Batman film, which is going to be like 4 hours long. Fuck that, man.
No, I'm done with DC films for a little while. I might come back for Black Adam, but no, the 4 hour Snyder cut of Justice League killed any enthusiasm I had for DC films going forward.
I'm still not that. I've still not seen that. I've never been that interested in the DC films. I prefer the Marvel ones.
I like Shazam. That's it.
It was definitely an okay one. That was one of the ones I was like, okay, no, that's an okay film.
Anyway, MCU films then, because we've got a lot of common ground, because I love No Way Home. I don't know your
thoughts on it. Oh, it was so good. Absolutely loved it.
So what's been your kind of top films in the... I saw also that you've watched the Harry Potter films quite often. It's another thing.
That's like full childhood nostalgia, that one.
Yeah, we went to see it. It was 20 years since Philosopher's Stone last year.
It would have been last year, 2001.
Yeah, so we went to see Philosopher's Stone in the cinema because it came out again, and then Azkaban came out not long after. We went to cinema to see that again, just because I've never seen them. The first one I saw in the cinema was Order of the Phoenix, and it was a fucking terrible film. It's the worst one. But
there's a funny story with my family. So we didn't go, we might have, like, this was 2001. I was very young, so I don't know if I went to go see it, but my family might have. So, don't remember going to see Philosopher's Stone, but we did go see Chamber of Secrets, and we saw the rest of them in cinemas after that. And my sister, she started reading Prisoner of Azkaban first. I think she got, like, read the other ones and got read to them in primary school, because that happens sometimes. But got to the scene. This was the first movie they let her hold popcorn. And they got to the scene where Harry puts the flu powder in, goes to the weird ass shop, and then just messing around with stuff, and the hand grabs him, and didn't know that was coming. So first time she holds popcorn, it just goes it flings the popcorn all the way over the... So yeah, that's a funny story from our family.
The old Nocturne Alley.
That place.
Sorry, I started on the MCU now. Veered right left. A center, right into Harry Potter. But yeah, MCU film. So, any particular favorites, standout ones for you? Ones that, Guardians of the Galaxy, I seem to mind.
Guardians of the Galaxy, Volume 1, definitely one of the top ones. I'd probably say my favorite and the one that I've watched the most would actually be Age of Ultron.
Really?
It does not get enough love.
I agree. It's quite low on my list because I like ones more, but it's not a bad film by any stretch, in my opinion, anyway. So I'm in absolute agreement with you there.
A lot of people, I remember hating it when it first came out because it was setting up a lot of things to come. Mm-hmm. And then after those things come, like, people loved them. I was like, okay, well then the setup should be just as loved. Like, show Ultron the love it deserves.
Yeah.
We've clearly seen, the most powerful force in all of Marvel Cinematic Universe, going by What If.
Yeah, and who knows where that's going to go now with Doctor Strange. I think when this comes out, we're still about a month or two away from Multiverse of Madness. And
yeah, it's still a wee bit away, but the rumor mills are going crazy on that one.
Oh yeah, stuff's going to be absolutely mad. I'm so excited for Spider-Man and seeing all the multiverse stuff. I don't know how I'm going to cope with Doctor Strange, but you know, I'm still going to pay my ticket and try and get in first night if I can.
Yeah, well, me and Spyro were trying to go see a few films every now and then. We actually saw the new Scream today. But it was a case of, like, we're planning on seeing the new Jackass film. We're definitely going to go see Multiverse of Madness when it comes out. Because they're determined that it's going to be House of M.
Right, yeah, and then they're going to kind of bring in all the Fox properties and then kind of kill them at the same time. Because, like, come in, guys, come in. You can all die. We're keeping Deadpool.
I know a big, like, theory going around at the moment is that they're going to have, like, the Illuminati of the multiverse or something, mm-hmm. which is going to have, like, the Reed Richards from the Fantastic Four films, Patrick Stewart is Professor X, maybe James McAvoy as well, and the weirdest one, Tom Cruise is Iron Man.
Yeah, that's...
Based off that, like, 80s fan art that came out a while ago.
That one seems to be coming around far too often for it to not be, like, dismissed entirely. I don't know what's happening, but yeah, I mean
it gives me a room to focus on, because if I can, like, just get all the rumors for that and none of the others, I'll be fine. Like, give me all the Tom Cruise rumors. I don't care about the others.
I know. Chris Evans is apparently going to be back as Human Torch as Johnny Storm and all that kind of stuff. I don't know. I'm just going to enjoy it. I mean, I was fairly certain I still don't want to spoil No Way Home for people. Yeah. Even at this point, it'll be out for 6 months. It'll probably be out in streaming by the time this actually goes out to people. But yeah, it's I knew of the rumors, but I was still not prepared for it.
Yeah, that was actually one of the things, because Spyro didn't really watch much of the trailers. Like, I think they watched the first one, but then didn't see anything after that. So she was like, oh, so-and-so is supposed to be in this one. It's like, we don't know. Like, that's not been confirmed yet. They've not been in any of the trailers, but the rumor is, so we don't know. We'll see.
So yeah, I'm waiting patiently for a totally legal streaming copy to come into my lap and watch it again, because it's just a beautiful film all around.
Yeah, when it goes on Disney Plus, it'll just be on repeat.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's got to go through Netflix first because of their Sony deal. Oh, or that. Yeah, but Sony. Even then, I'll be watching it.
I'll be on repeat on Netflix then. That's all it is.
Absolutely. I'll have my phone next to me at my workstation. I'll just have it No Way Home on the whole time. What a day that's going to be. What a week. What a month. What a year. So, outside of that, I only found out today, really, that you do a little bit of YouTubing yourself. So I was again looking through my research, my very thorough research, and I came across Saz and Maz on YouTube.
Yep.
Which, as we discussed beforehand, this will probably be the first time a lot of the people that have seen you wrestle or trained you will know this exists.
I think out of all the people that kind of work in the WrestleZone space, Spyro is the only one that knows about it.
So what's the story behind Saz and Maz?
All right, so Saz, for those who don't know, Saz and Maz, me and my mate, I'm in this scenario, I'm Maz, she's Saz. We've been friends for, Jesus Christ, nearly 10 years now. And we've always kind of been massive nerds, if you couldn't guess by the MCU Harry Potter talk. And so we had a lot of sort of interest that we kind of keep up on. We watch, like, over lockdown, they got me into D&D. We used to, like, watch a lot of cartoons and theorize on stuff. And it was just a case of, we always wanted to do YouTube stuff. Like, don't know if you've heard of Red versus Blue.
Heard like, of it, yeah.
Yeah, it was like when the 10th season was coming out, she saw an animated music video, which was like a bunch of clips of it, played to Hall of Fame. So now we have a script that is just going to be, which for some reason has a fight to that song in it. It's like just a fan thing for it, which we've always just kind of been a running gag with us. And we just kind of thought, okay, well, if we want to do that, we need to have a channel that's at least got some sort of content on it to begin with. But we had to think of an easy thing to do because I live in Scotland. She lives in Wales.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
So it's a case of, okay, this is going to be difficult. And just one day, I think I saw something very similar. And then I remember, like, I saw someone do something similar on YouTube, and then it reminded me of Mystery Science Theater 3000. So I watched some of that, and I thought, wait, this would be really easy to do. We just cut out all the bits in between of the jokes, and then we just did that. What should we do? Oh, I know. We'll take the piss out of modern cartoons. So that's basically what we did. We just picked a couple cartoons that we thought, what could very easily we take the piss out of, but also seems to have a big enough following online. So we've settled on the three we were originally going to settle on was Steven Universe, Gravity Falls, and She-Ra, like the new one on Netflix. And we eventually realized probably don't do She-Ra because those are like half an hour to 40 minute episodes. They take a long fucking time to make.
Hey.
Yeah, so it's just a case of I have the episode on. If I think of a joke, then I'll just pause it and then write the joke down, order them so we kind of alternate lines essentially, and then send it off, get the recording back, and then just quickly edit it together. Say quickly, takes me a couple hours, but
editing's the worst thing when it comes to anything YouTube related. I found I speak to Alex Webb, and he was confused. Editing seems to be his favorite bit. I'm like, you're mad. And you're absolutely nuts, because that's...
Well, I don't mind editing certain things, because we've done a couple other things on the channel. The riffs are what we do the most. Mm-hmm. But I've done like a fitness parody, like fitness challenge parody on there.
That was the one that popped up as soon as I went on, and I was like, this is a bit different from Mauler Murphy. I kind of like it, but it's a bit different. So who knows? Yeah, maybe
that's me just full on taking the piss out of myself.
Who knows? Maybe after Mauler Murphy's been tamed, we'll get some of that on WrestleZone. You never know.
Maybe we'll see.
Things have happened. So that's back true. So it's a so YouTube stuff. So it's something different. Like I said, when I spotted it today, I was like, I'm gonna have to speak about it. I'm gonna please ask about it because it's not something I expected to see. Especially when I'm like speaking to the big monster himself, Mauler Murphy.
No one really expects when they see me in the ring to then he's gonna be watching a children's cartoon and just swearing every single second.
You've done pretty well this episode. We've only got an hour in. I don't think we've sworn too much. We're doing okay.
I think we got on a couple of mine, but it helps that I work in a very family-friendly organization for my wrestling. So I'm more used to trying to keep my potty mouth to a minimal.
I mean, we're saying that of course, Summer Hill Showdown, Ronan King got blatantly left out.
I was watching the mosh pit for Summer Hill because I wasn't actually there at the show. Wasn't able to get the day off work, and there was that many restrictions about how people could be there. So I was like, I'm probably just not going to turn up because I'm just going to take up room. I'm not going to really be able to help out in any way. So I'll make sure to try and get Ellen off. And then I saw the mosh pit, was laughing along at it. Saw a little clip of his match at the end where Rowan let out the F-bomb. And I was just like, oh, kid. I felt bad for him because I know how he must have felt.
Oh, well, again, I'm going to have him in a couple of weeks, so I'm definitely going to ask about it because, you know, he's not going to get away with it. But I didn't even hear it. I don't know how I didn't, because when I watched the clip, I was like, how did I not hear him swear? It was just there. But no, I missed it.
Did you think that just see that one little line of him saying how great he was that was the bit where the crowd were going to go, oh, no, don't like that. No, he said he's too good too many times now.
I don't know what it was. I think it's because when I go to a wrestling show, I don't expect to hear sweating. My brain just kind of filters it all out. And I missed it entirely.
Literally, when it happened, I was like, wait, hold on.
I know.
Rewinded, I was like, oh, he did say what I thought he said.
That's the thing, everyone. Oh, and then my wife turned to me and went, did he just swear? I was like, no, I didn't hear him swear. What's up? And I was front row. I was literally maybe 2 meters away from him. I heard nothing. I didn't hear that thing. It was just... I was almost embarrassed for myself, just going, I missed it. But anyway, hopefully you've now seen the mistake being made. It's not going to be in Mauler Murphy's future.
No, I don't.
Never know, though. Touch wood. So before we wrap up,
we'll be in WrestleZone anyway.
Yeah. Okay. Well, again, we'll touch wood on that. So again, we'll kind of steer back to wrestling and wrap up because I've had you for over an hour now, and if we end up back on the nerdy topics, we'll be here for a lot longer, so we'll go back into wrestling. I know that you at this point you've fought what, 2, 3, 4, 6 matches, so it's kind of a bit presumptuous of me to ask, but is there any opponents that you want to get in the ring with, say, in the next 12 months? Is there a particular opponent?
There's definitely a lot of guys I want to get in the ring with. Kind of the really obvious ones, like I want to get in the ring with Crusher at some point. Caleb. Like, who doesn't want to get in the ring with Caleb at this point? Mm-hmm. Dynamite, definitely. Actually, just all the Foundation. Like, they're all really good. So I'd like to test myself against them.
And outside of WrestleZone, is there any guys? I mean, I don't know how much...
Probably Andy Wild.
Yeah, that seems to be on top of everyone's list, I think.
Yeah, Andy Wild. He's like Caleb. Who doesn't want to fight Andy?
Yeah, absolutely. And the other question we ask for, and any promotions, or are you just concentrating on your time in WrestleZone first?
Currently, I'm focusing on WrestleZone. I just want to, iron out some kinks before I eventually try and go elsewhere. I think the worst thing I could do right now is just try and get myself to as many places as I can.
Mm-hmm. All right, so get everything in order before yeah.
Get to a point where elsewhere. I know I'm good enough, and then just makes it all the better.
Yeah. So, and the last question we try to ask people now, outside of our silly questions, is you'll be given the book Dream Match, main event at WrestleMania, or whatever your favorite promotion is, their biggest show. You get the main event, you get to choose your opponent or opponents and your match. Who would it be? So, it could be anyone, mainly someone who it's a possibility, like active, nobody dead, pretty much. That's kind of how.
Okay, so alive is.
Alive is, I mean, dead is going to be an easy win for you, but alive preferred. Who'd it be?
I don't know. There's some people that are dead that'll probably still get the win. Oof. Dream Philly opponent. I would originally say Triple H, but like rumors are he's retired right now, so I'll let him rest. So I would say currently, probably Drew Galloway. Specifically Galloway, not McIntyre. I want Galloway.
Yeah, good choice. Just a straight up singles match. Would you throw in a stipulation in there?
If we're doing Galloway, we'd throw in a no DQ, I'd say.
Fair enough. Excellent. Well, I mean, this has been, again, when I come into these chats and I don't have like an awful lot of notes, well, thankfully I was able to find stuff, of course, about YouTube stuff today and your film enjoyment, which again matched up with mine, so it was great. But I'm almost scared that there's going to be like half an hour episodes and we'll be like, well, I've run out of things to speak about. We'll just go then. But no, I think it's been quite an insightful chat and insightful finding out more about Mauler Murphy, and I look forward to, hopefully, if you're in the, I'm going to guess you're in the Rumble, but we won't know until, of course, you're announced for it.
I'll never tell.
Exactly. That's the way it should be. Okay, what's the word, kayfabe? So yes, this has been a fascinating chat. I've really enjoyed. Where can people find you on social media if they want to find out more?
My Twitter is at Mauler Murphy. I don't remember what my Instagram is, but I think it's the same thing. Shows how much I use social media.
If you type in Mauler Murphy, it'll appear, I'm sure.
Yeah, there's not that many people with that name, so like you'll find me easy enough.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thanks very much for joining me today.
That's no problem.